10, 10, 10 endometrial polyps in women with postprandial causal bleeding justifies removal of systematic review and meta-analysis.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. There are many uncertainties around polyps or normally looking polyps in postmenopausal bleeding women. One, the exact prevalence of polyps is unknown, it varies in the literature. The exact prevalence of hyperplasia and cancer in polyps is also widely varies in the literature. Also, to remove or to adopt expectant management in some women. Most studies included a mixture of pre- and post-menopausal women, both symptomatic and asymptomatic. There is no evidence could be produced from a randomized controlled trial and the three systematic reviews and meta-analyses in the literature. Therefore, it is very difficult to produce guidelines for management. The only randomized controlled trial stopped after 26 months because both doctors and women were reluctant about allocation to the expectant arm. The three systematic reviews are full of heterogeneity in population and outcome measures, so we couldn't produce evidence. Therefore, we quantified the prevalence of hyperplasia and cancer in normally looking endometrial polyps with normal background endometrium in women with postmenopausal bleeding. In the hope to produce data that help inform clinical practice as whether it is safer to remove all polyps or some women might adopt expectant management. Our search strategy was thorough. We searched PubMed, embased clinicaltrial.gov, and also hand search for the bibliography list of the included studies. Our main eligibility criteria was separate analysis for women with postmenopausal bleeding. Out of more than 2,600 papers covering the topic, we finally included 10, which fulfilled our eligibility criteria. We did quality in prognosis studies tool as a quality assessment for risk of bias. 2 out of the 10 included studies showed low risk of bias, 5 moderate, 3 high. I-square statistic showed 77% substantial heterogeneity. Therefore, we adopted random effect rather than fixed effect model. And the pooled prevalence of cancer and hyperplasia in normally looking polyp in women with postmenopausal bleeding with normal background endometrium was 8.9%. The sources of heterogeneity could be different population because different studies grouped cancer and hyperplasia differently. Some considered simple hyperplasia as normal. Some grouped hyperplasia together, some grouped atypical hyperplasia with cancer. Also different methodology, one study out of the 10 were prospective, the rest was retrospective. To adjust for small studies effect, we used the trim and fill method, and the adjustment had no influence on the pooled prevalence estimate, i.e. there was no publication bias. To add robustness to our estimate, we used one study removed cross-validation as a sensitivity analysis, and no study exerted a big influence on the pooled prevalence. This is the first study in the literature that includes homogeneous population or relatively homogeneous population of only women with postmenopausal bleeding and endometrial polyps. The prevalence is 8.9. It is high enough to suggest that the option of expectant management of this woman should only be considered with caution. Polyps should be removed to obtain histopathological assessment and probably prevent recurrent PMB. The real dilemma is when office morcellation is technically difficult or unacceptable to women, particularly those with comorbidities or a small polyp less than 1.5 centimeter, would it be justified to put them asleep if the polyp appear normal and the endometrial biopsy is negative? The main challenge that faced us during this meta-analysis that we're not able to quantify epidemiological and the clinical predictors of hyperplasia and cancer in polyps because of inconsistent or lack reporting. Therefore, we couldn't do subgroup analysis or meta-regression. Including these predictors in the analysis might have explain some of the heterogeneity observed. I mean by the epidemiological and the clinical predictors, age, hypertension, obesity, tamoxifen, diabetes, etc. A large multi-center prospective study is required to settle this debate. This should take into consideration the epidemiological and the clinical predictors of hyperplasia and cancer in polyps. I would like to thank my collaborators, especially my research fellow Ahmed Gubara and Dr. Malcolm Price, the statistician, and thank you very much.